Good evening, everyone. I'd like to call the regular Plan Commission meeting of November 19th to order. Gail, may we have a roll call, please?
Doyle?
Here.
Hassan?
Here.
Lal?
Here.
DiBernardo?
Here.
Trapinski, not here. Trapinski?
Here. We have a quorum. Tonight, first, I would like to introduce a new Plan Commissioner. His name is Richard DiBernardo. He is here to take the place of Simon Shears, who has retired from the Plan Commission. And at this time, I'd like to thank Simon for all the outstanding contribution he did as a Plan Commissioner and the many times he's also contributed in the audience and as a reporter for the Oak Brook Civic Association newsletter. We are very grateful for all his commentaries and especially his interest in energy conservation. And welcome to Richard. The first item on the agenda is approval of the meeting of minutes. There are 2 minutes of meeting that have to be approved tonight. The first one is from a meeting of September 17th. May I have a motion to approve those minutes as written?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. The minutes are approved as written. The second item on the agenda is approval of the minutes of meeting for September 26th. May I have a motion to approve those as written?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
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 Those minutes of meeting are approved. Tonight, we have no unfinished business, but we do have new business, and this is going to be for a public hearing. This is the official public hearing for the Commercial Areas Revitalization Plan, and this is the only item on the agenda tonight. I'd like to mention to the members in the audience, if there's anyone in the audience who want to speak at tonight's meeting, to please go and sign in the back. What we are going to do first is we are going to hear from our Director of Community Development, and then we'll be hearing a presentation from John Halseal. After that, I'll open the meeting to members of the audience for any questions or comments they have. And after that, then the Plan Commissioners will ask questions and make their comments. Prior to, I'm going to let the presentation start, but when we're ready to speak from the audience members, well, then everyone who is going to be speaking will have to be sworn in. Is that okay?
It's all right.
Okay, our village attorney had recommended maybe I should swear everybody in right now. All those who are planning to speak at tonight's meeting, if you please rise. Can you please raise your right hand? Do you swear or affirm that the testimony you are about to give at this hearing will be the truth?
I do.
Okay, thank you very much. Please be seated. With that, Tony, I'll turn it over to you.
Good evening. Tony Budzikowski, Development Services Director for the Village. I also have with me, as you mentioned, John Halseal, who's a principal and our planner for this particular plan. He's a principal with Halseal Levine and Associates. And also, as part of this introduction of the plan, we're going to have Jeff Kennedy, who's the chairman of the Community Enhancement Committee, and he's been working with this plan for the better part of 2 years with John. Just want to do a quick intro to this. As I mentioned, we've been working on this for approximately 2 years. It's an amendment to our 2007 Commercial Area Revitalization Plan. And this is a development guide. Unlike our zoning requirements, subdivision requirements, this is a future land use guide for the commercial areas as identified in this plan, which is really the geographic area extending along 22nd Street and Butterfield Road. Includes the Oak Brook Center, as well as arterials that run along York Road, Jory Boulevard to the south, as well as Route 8 83 to the north of 22nd Street. And this particular plan will emphasize land use plan recommendations, transportation and circulation, and design guidelines. And I want to emphasize that this process, this public hearing, this is really one of the first steps for public comment. We've had multiple board meetings. We've also had community enhancement committee meetings, but this is an opportunity for public comment, questions related to the plan. And I anticipate this evening, the Plan Commission will continue this meeting to another public hearing next month to give them an opportunity to get additional comments, as well as kind of digest what's gone on at this meeting. And from a process standpoint, at some point, the Plan Commission will provide a recommendation on this plan, and that recommendation could be different than the plan we're looking at right now. This October 2018 draft, it's in the Plan Commission's purview to make recommendations on whether they would like to see this particular plan as is. They could have other recommendations, changes in some of the sub areas that they feel are more appropriate, and they will make a recommendation to our Village Board, who will make a decision on this plan eventually and adopt a plan. So that's kind of the process in a nutshell, and I will let John continue. Oh, I'm sorry, I will let Jeff Kennedy start us off here. Thank you.
Good evening, Madam Chairman and members of the Plan Commission. When Tony introduced me and he said Jeff has been working on this for, I thought he was going to say most of his life, because it does, as I will explain, go back a ways. It was 11 years ago that John Housiel, our consultant, Bob Colleen, and I came before the commission to present the commercial revitalization plan of 2007. Some of you were on the commission at that time. For perspective, in 2005, the village had launched the Commercial Areas Revitalization Project and created the Commercial Revitalization Committee, which is now called the Community Enhancement Committee. The committee is currently comprised of 6 business representatives and 9 residents. The impetus for this project was that Oak Brook's commercial buildings were becoming outdated and in some cases obsolete, and that our traffic infrastructure, our commercial zoning, and our comprehensive plan were woefully out of date. Frankly, Oak Brook was losing its preeminence as the commercial place to be in the western suburbs. After nearly 2 years of work and numerous drafts and meetings, the committee unanimously approved the plan of 2007, which was ultimately presented to this board, unanimously approved by this board, and then unanimously adopted by the Board of Trustees as the official plan for Oak Brook's commercial districts, not residential, commercial. In the 13 years since this project was launched, great strides have been made in revitalizing our commercial areas. For its part, the village has made major progress. The widening of 22nd Street under the I-88 bridge to eliminate a terrible bottleneck. The widening and rebuilding of 22nd Street to the west of Route 83 to Butterfield to, again, eliminate a major bottleneck. Major streetscape improvements have been made on 22nd Street from Spring all the way to I-294. 3.5 crosswalk sidewalk corridors have been constructed between Oak Brook Center and the surrounding offices, hotels, etc., improving walkability and reducing traffic flow. The Planned Unit Development Commission has been created. We've adopted a plan unit development ordinance for consideration of complex projects, which gives the village more control and flexibility in approving those projects. We, the village, have adopted a modern signage ordinance, and new corporate headquarters have been attracted to the village, most notably the Hub Group headquarters, the Duchessois Group headquarters, Rasmussen University, and others. In addition to those projects that are now complete, we have three projects currently actively underway at either the construction or the design phase. One is the rebuilding, which you can see, it's already begun, the rebuilding of the bridge across on York Road across the I-88 main line. That will be followed by modernization, reconstruction, signalization of the intersection of York and Harger with direct access to I-88 West, eliminating again some traffic congestion in the northeast quadrant of the village. The widening of the bridge and roadway of Windsor Drive north of 22nd Street to eliminate traffic congestion. Hopefully that is going to include a ramp from that area, the Windsor Swift area, onto I-294 west, south. We're working now with the tollway on that. And then the third major project that soon will be underway is the beautification of Jory Boulevard from 22nd Street all the way down to Village Hall, sort of in the same vein as the beautification improvements that have been made on 22nd Street. While the village has made great progress in stimulating and facilitating commercial revitalization, economic development, and redevelopment, the private sector has made even greater progress in bringing that to reality. Bear in mind, it's the private sector that brings forth projects and provides the financial funding for development. Look at some of the major successes from the private sector in the last 11 years. The construction of the Oak Brook Promenade with all of its exciting restaurants and shops, the partial build-out of the Clearwater development, three very major additions or rebuilds at Oak Brook Center, as well as many, many tenant upgrades of their spaces, construction of the new leading-edge headquartered buildings for Hub Group and Duchessois, the construction of the new Rush Oak Brook Hospital opening next month, or in January, construction of the new Hyatt Hotel at Windsor and 22nd, the renovation and reopening of the long-shuttered Drake Hotel, the renovation and opening of La Meridian Hotel, the opening of more new restaurants than I can count, and a lot more. Obviously, by the way, this commission has played a major role in many of those developments. All of this progress has resulted from a collaborative effort between the village and the private sector to do great things for Oak Brook. The village has played its proper role, which is to accommodate, facilitate, and stimulate economic development. And to upgrade infrastructure, particularly traffic infrastructure. And the private sector has provided the initiative on these projects and the funding for these projects. While the village has spent millions of dollars on infrastructure projects, the private sector, I estimate, has spent probably over $1 billion in the last 11 years in economic development and redevelopment in Oak Brook. All the more impressive is that we've made this progress and we've achieved this advancement in the face of the 2008 Great Recession, the pressures on state and local governments for revenues for capital projects, the e-commerce assault on brick-and-mortar retail, including at Oak Brook Center, and in spite of the flight of corporations from the suburbs to the city. I think as a result of these achievements over the past 11 years, Oak Brook's commercial areas today are far more vibrant, modern, and attractive than they were 11 years ago. By any measure, the Commercial Revitalization Project and the Commercial Revitalization Plan of 2007 have been a success. And I think it's fair to say that through these collaborative efforts of the private sector and the village, we are now regaining our preeminence as the commercial place to be in the western suburbs. We're not there yet, but we're coming. But a lot is left to be done. So 2 years ago, village staff and the Community Enhancement Committee decided it was time to update the 2007 Commercial Revitalization Plan for four main reasons. First of all, as I've said, a lot of the recommendations of that plan have already been accomplished. They're done. They're in place. They're moot. Secondly, the plan needs to be revised to take account of the new development that has taken place and the additional challenges that some of that new development presents. Thirdly, with McDonald's move from Oak Brook to the city, the village needs to play a role in the repositioning of those McDonald's properties. And finally, with the burgeoning development in the York, Windsor, Swift area, the village now has to deal with some chronic traffic congestion issues and infrastructure issues that need addressing. So those are the four factors that have driven the creation of the updated plan, draft plan before you tonight. No other substantial changes are recommended to the plan of 07 because it has proven so successful so far. The updated plan before you tonight is a result of nearly 2 years of fact-finding and work by Jen Housiel and the committee, several lengthy meetings of the committee, and the review of three or four draft versions. The Community Enhancement Committee unanimously approved submitting the current draft to the board last February. Now, during the 2 years of work on this draft, circumstances have been rapidly changing, particularly regarding the McDonald's properties, the Park District referendum on the Kensington site, the numerous developmental changes, developments at Oak Brook Center, and other development proposals. As a result, the draft has evolved, and it's still evolving. It's really kind of a good news, bad news situation. The bad news is that things are changing so fast that it's hard for John Housiel and the committee and staff to keep up in terms of the plan. That's the bad news. The good news is there's a heck of a lot of good development work underway in Oak Brook, so we're busy. Now, as Tony has said, the committee may want to amend some of the plan's language and recommendations. That's the reason we're going through this process. But the plan itself is overwhelmingly, I think, sound, progressive, and beneficial to the village. As one would expect, there has been some criticism of the updated plan at two lengthy meetings of the village board and other meetings on specific development projects. But virtually all of that criticism has been based, I think, on a misconception of the plan. So let me put the plan in perspective. Virtually none of the criticism directed at the plan relates to the plan's proposals for commercial or for traffic infrastructure, which is 98% of the plan before you tonight. No criticism of its recommendations on commercial or traffic infrastructure. Virtually all the criticism is instead directed at the 2% of the plan's recommendations for introducing a residential component into some mixed-use developments within the commercial districts. The plan does not touch any of Oak Brook's 27 residential subdivisions, except to strongly preserve, recommend strongly preserving the existing separations of those subdivisions from our commercial districts. So nothing in the plan will affect the internal ambience or privacy of Oak Brook's residential subdivisions, or affect the experience of those residents who prefer the traditional single-family residence lifestyle. All the plan recommends as to residential is that the village favorably consider mixed-use developments, again, within the commercial districts that will include condos, thereby accommodating residents who prefer a downsized condo lifestyle and those who prefer to live within walking distance of shopping, restaurants, entertainment, conveniences, and their workplaces. In essence, the updated plan recommends that the village add an additional optional residential lifestyle within our commercial districts to accommodate primarily seniors, millennials, and others who prefer a more walkable lifestyle. This proposed plan's endorsement of residential components within mixed uses is not new. No less than 7 times in the existing 2007 plan, the use of residential components in mixed-use developments is strongly recommended, in essentially the same language that's in the plan tonight, the revised plan tonight. While the plan identifies multiple sites potentially suited for residential elements within mixed-use developments, that certainly doesn't mean that all those sites are going to be developed with a condominium component. The market will determine how many condos will be built based on demand and economics. Oak Brook is not going to become overrun by condos. Look at the history. Although the 2007 plan strongly encouraged including condos in mixed-use developments, not one condo has been built in Oak Brook in those 11 years. And only 2 have come forward as proposals before our approval bodies. Why should Oak Brook accommodate residential condos as part of mixed-use developments in our commercial districts? The world is changing. It's always changing. Demographics are changing. Lifestyle preferences are changing. Little history. Before the end of World War II, Americans basically lived in cities or small towns. Those were the 2 options. Following World War II, the preferences of younger people dramatically changed. They wanted the tranquility of suburban life, single-family homes, good schools, low crime, and away from the hustle and bustle of the city. So suburbs like Oak Brook thrived following World War II. Now, almost a half century later, we're going through another sea change. So-called millennials and younger people, many of them, prefer a more urban lifestyle. They're staying single longer. They're having kids later. They like the exciting life of the city. They don't want to own cars. They don't want to own single-family homes. They don't want to have to commute from the suburb to the city. Unlike their predecessors after World War II, who wanted to work in the suburbs. Simply put, a lot of younger people today want to live, work, shop, dine, enjoy life in a walkable, urban-type environment, something that Oak Brook simply doesn't answer. Why should we care? A couple reasons that I think are important. As we all know, Oak Brook is almost totally dependent on our strong commercial sector for the revenues that finance this village and our schools. And those companies are telling us, telling our committee, telling me at Chamber of Commerce Economic Development Council meetings, that they're having a hard time attracting and retaining younger workers, in large part because Oak Brook does not offer the residential options such as condos, and it doesn't offer the walkability, the ability to live where you work, near where you work, within walking distance of where you work, to enjoy walking to shopping, entertainment, restaurants, etc. So our businesses are facing a challenge in recruiting the young talent they need. Indeed, that's the reason McDonald's has given for its move from Oak Brook to Chicago. And McDonald's is not the only one. We know of many, many corporations around our area that have moved their corporate headquarters downtown primarily for the reason, or at least for the given reason, that they have to do that in order to recruit the young talent they need to keep their businesses going. The other reason for why we should consider condos in Oak Brook is obviously at the other end of the age spectrum, and that is our seniors. We're an aging population. We know that. And a lot of older people want to downsize. They like the condominium lifestyle. They want to stay at Oak Brook. Right now, they've got one option, basically, and that's the Oak Brook Club. And fortunately, the Oak Brook Club is fully occupied. So what will this plan update mean for Oak Brook? I think in all likelihood, over the coming years, we might see two or three projects with a condominium component going forward, being approved and built. The free market will decide which sites move forward and when. And if we reach the point that we have enough condos in Oak Brook, the market will self-correct. They simply won't build or propose any more condos. That's the wonder of our free enterprise system, one of the wonders. As Tony said, the plan before you tonight is a guide. It does not dictate land uses. We don't order developers to build this there and that here. The private sector will determine what is proposed, and this commission, the Zoning Board, the Plan Unit Development Commission, and the Village Board, ultimately, will decide what gets approved. So to hit the highlights, by way of summary, I think by virtue of careful, insightful planning and the maintenance of very high development standards, Oak Brook has been and still is a preeminent, unique community. And this updated plan seeks to retain that and build upon it in ways necessary to maintain what is outstanding about Oak Brook. But the world is changing in ways that challenge part of the original 1950 model for Oak Brook. Those changes are epitomized by the relocation of McDonald's, which we did not think would ever happen. Epitomized by the mass relocations of corporate headquarters from the suburbs to the city, and by the different lifestyle preferences of younger workers. We need to update the model. We can't stick our head in the sands and pretend we're still living in the 1950s and 1960s, because we're not. And we can't stick our fingers in the dike and stop the onslaught of the e-commerce revolution, the preferences, the lifestyle preferences of younger people, and corporate strategies. We can't stop that. We have to accommodate it as best we can. So yes, we've made a lot of progress since 2005 when this whole effort started, but I think we're at a critical turning point now, particularly with McDonald's departure. We've got a lot of space to fill. Brick and mortar is under assault. Lifestyle patterns of younger people, younger workers needed by our corporations are changing. But despite these challenges, Oak Brook still has most of its preeminent appeal. And there's tremendous opportunity, in my view, to further enhance that. It's no secret the private sector is currently very interested in investing in Oak Brook. Numerous proposals are beginning to come forward, beginning to enter the pipeline. But developers are watchfully waiting to see whether the village is still committed to commercial revitalization as it was in 2005, 2006, 2007 when we launched this. So on behalf of the committee, the Enhancement Committee, I urge this commission to carefully consider this proposed plan, and to approve it and move it on to the village. We've created a lot of momentum here in the last 11, 12 years. Let's keep the momentum going. Thank you.
Good evening, Madam Chairman and members of the Plan Commission and everybody in attendance. My name is John Hausiel with Hausiel Levine Associates. Tough to follow Tony and Jeff because they do such a good job of articulating what it is they're talking about. So what I'm going to do this evening is what I've done now. It's sort of deja vu several times in this room over the last year. I'll present a very brief overview of the document. It's been available online for about a month, and essentially the same version minus a couple of minor tweaks for several months. So I think most of the people in the room and at the dais is probably familiar with it, but I want to get it on the record and to orient people who may not have had the orientation I'm about to give. A couple of things that I think are important that Tony stated, as did Jeff. This is a draft for discussion purposes. It's labeled on every page until the gavel comes down and it gets approved. In whatever state it gets approved or not approved, it's open for discussion, and that's what the purpose of this process is. I will note that the version that came out of the Enhancement Committee and recommended to the Village Board for sending it to here for public hearing, as indicated by both Tony and Jeff, there were lengthy meetings in this room with the Village Board. At those meetings, several comments were made. At the second meeting, the meeting a month before last, there was actually an open public hearing and they took testimony from the public. So there are several people, both residents as well as members of the business community, Enhancement Committee members, local business leaders, and other organizations and stakeholders made public comment regarding the draft at the time. So the draft from a couple of months ago. Based on the feedback and discussion from those meetings and that public hearing at the Committee of the Whole, there was some specific direction given or requested by the board that we take a look and see if we couldn't address the plan or modify it to reflect some of the comments that were made. So we've made a few of those changes in the draft that's been available now for a month and the draft that you have for public hearing. As I go through this, I'll highlight what the changes were from that came out of being responsive to all the people that spoke at both the first Village Board meeting and the public hearing at the Committee of the Whole. So with this said, I'll go through this fairly quickly. This is an actual PDF of the draft plan. Oh, yeah, go ahead. Probably help you see it a little bit better. And again, I'll go through it fairly quickly, and then as we go forward, Madam Chairman, we can address anything in more detail as questions come up. So first, I'm going to go through sort of the content of the plan itself. Introduction, land use plan and policies, commercial and office areas, residential areas, transportation and circulation, and then a series of sub-area framework plans where we dove a little bit deeper into the different areas of the corridor, because it couldn't all be treated with a sort of a homogenous approach. It had to be different treatments in different areas of the corridor. So the first chapter is an introduction that identifies the area of the study and provides some of the context for what was being done and the process that was undertaken and the vision for the commercial area revitalization. It's too bad I can't have like an embedded voice recording. I would have just put in here what Jeff just said to provide the context over the last decade of how this plan came about. The second section is land use plans and policies. And we talk about some of the key principles that fed into the plan throughout, strengthening the economic vitality of the commercial areas, proactively identifying redevelopment opportunities, easy access of the employment areas, maintaining quality development. We then begin to identify the different land use designations. So I'll go through these very quickly because you'll see these on all the maps. So the commercial and office uses, we have mixed use. Mixed use, when we refer to that in the document, is largely retail or commercial on the ground floor, maybe retail, maybe surface, maybe restaurant, with residential or office units potentially above. So when we say mixed use, it's mixed use vertically in a building. neighborhood commercial, sort of that smaller scale commercial. Regional commercial is the larger retail or shopping areas that do not have a residential component or even the possibility of such. Oak Brook Center is its own. Hotel and lodging, professional office, business park. Then we get into the residential uses, single family detached, single family attached. That's row homes, townhomes, things like that. Multifamily is condominiums, could be apartments. Public utilities, semi-public uses, parks and open spaces, and public utility. This is the land use plan for the commercial areas document. And again, as stated by both Tony and by Jeff, this plan doesn't make any changes to the residential areas, whether they be single family detached or single family attached residential neighborhoods of the village. We don't touch them. What you'll see up here is these large areas in yellow. This is shown for context. What you see in sort of the blue and the reds, these are the commercial areas where we've made recommended changes. But because a lot of people will look at a plan and say, I live here, they associate with that, they recognize it. The residential areas were shown because they are adjacent to the commercial. So we want people to be able to see that adjacency for context reasons, but no changes have been made to any of the residential areas in the village. So what you'll see here, I'll go through it real quickly. Light yellow is single family residential. The darker is single family attached, like townhomes. Multifamily condominiums are the brown. Mixed use is that, again, commercial ground floor, office, or residential potential above. Neighborhood commercial is this area on Midwest. Unlike some of the regional commercial, the really large commercial that you see on the corridor, Midwest has a lot of much smaller, different types of commercial. It's a totally different character of commercial. So we call that out separately. Oak Brook Center is its own sort of land use category. Then we have hotel and lodging is in orange, just to call out where those are. Professional office is the darker blue. And then the lighter blue is sort of a business park with a little bit more flexibility and not just straight up corporate office. So this is the commercial area plans and policies where we isolate all the commercial areas. Same as the land use plan before, but we take the residential off and show just the commercial. We then go through each one of these commercial principles to talk about the key recommendations for neighborhood commercial, and then we identify where the different types of commercial are in the corridor. So this is the mixed use commercial. These are all the potential commercial mixed use areas. And I'll go back here. One of the things that I think that was not mentioned yet, and it was at the public hearing and at the first village board meeting, there's initially some people who commented on it. Again, there was a lot of support. I kept an unofficial tally at the committee of the whole meeting. And by about 3 or 4 to 1, commentary was generally in favor versus the people that had some issues with the document. One of the issues was the amount of areas where you could potentially have mixed use. It's the striped area. There's actually less mixed use area designated in this plan than it was mixed use areas dedicated 11 years ago. So we've actually reduced the number of areas where you could potentially have mixed use in the commercial areas. I think it's a significant thing because I think people thought it was a new idea. It's not. But we talk about the different recommendations for neighborhood commercial, regional commercial. You can see it here, the big box, or the bigger parcels, excuse me, that exist along 22nd Street and a little bit up here. Oak Brook Center, all the different hotels and lodging locations that you have. And the office areas, both traditional office, as well as sort of these new business park types of things with a little bit more flexibility than traditional corporate office. For each one of these, we have detailed recommendations on the different improvements for these areas. We then get into general improvements on development guidelines. These are guidelines used to improve the sites as development comes in and something is proposed. They should be held to these standards when the Plan Commission and Village Board are evaluating a proposal for potential approval or modification or denial. So we talk about the design of sites and buildings within the commercial areas. We talk about how access and circulation should be designed to be safe and appropriate for the mix of uses. How parking lots and parking structures should be designed and located. We talk about landscaping, streetscaping, and screening. And there was more in this 11 years ago because, as Jeff said, this largely has been done or completed except for certain areas. So it's a much smaller component this time around. And then this is one of the things I'll stop and comment on. One of the things that was stated And it was a discussion point at the Committee of the Whole meeting, public hearing, was the issue of floodplain and other environmental considerations. And after some discussion back and forth from some residents and stakeholders and board members, village president asked, he said, would you be able to put some of this language in here and show the floodplain and talk about the floodplain and put it in the plan? So when village president asked me to do something, I said, of course, yes, sir. We'll get right on that. And we did. So let me go back. Both in the commercial areas maps and the residential area maps, you will see, it's hard to see on this and I apologize, floodplain has been indicated based on GIS map layers of best available data. And the source here was the preliminary FEMA maps dated 6/1/2017. And so all the floodplain area, according to this 2017 FEMA data, is now on the commercial areas map. So you can see where it is. So any properties encumbered currently with floodplain is now marked on the maps. That was a specific request. That's a change over the one that came out of the enhancement committee. And in addition to that was this added section here about the need when reviewing all development to look at environmental considerations. And so this section, Oakbrook contains many environmental amenities and assets, including mature stands of trees, beautiful open spaces, and accessible water features. These features are found in both the commercial and residential areas of the village. As new development is proposed in the village's commercial areas, consideration must be given to ensuring Oakbrook remain good stewards of the natural environment. The very first one talks directly about floodplain, which is what was asked. Portions of the commercial districts are in floodplains, and appropriate measures should be taken to ensure that proper handling of all such areas before developing or building in areas designated as floodplain, developers and property owners must comply with all applicable stormwater management requirements and obtain all necessary permits from village, county, state, and or federal authorities. So we wanted to make sure that it was shown on the maps where it is. We wanted to show on the maps all the commercial properties that were encumbered by floodplain. We wanted to source the data of the floodplain information, and we wanted to put in here the requirement that all areas so encumbered meet all these requirements. And then we go on to talk about other types of environmental considerations beyond floodplain. So this section is new, based on feedback from the committee, a whole meeting, public hearing a month ago. We then get into residential area plans and policies. And again, the light yellow is single family existing neighborhoods. We don't touch those. This is the residential development. Again, we don't touch that. What you're really looking at here is a couple of different things. One is the mixed use areas where we say there's a potential to have condominiums on the upper floors. And then the other largest one is, and I'll address this a little bit later, is what we are calling sort of the, I think it's called the Kensington property is what you refer to it as. In the document, it's called the McDonald's Fields properties or sites. And that we have labeled as residential. And I'll talk about that a little bit later. So in the residential areas, we talk about all the different residential areas and how they contribute to the village and how that's handled. But again, we don't change any of the existing residential. I did miss, Madam Chairman, one thing that was also specifically stated. It was asked that we address or put in here sort of in the introductory section the importance of quality, character, and high standards in the village of Oakbrook, just sort of, you know, to put that in there. And at the very first page on page one, right after the first introductory paragraphs, is a section called A Legacy of Quality, Character, and High Standards. So again, that couple of paragraphs on page one was put in here at a direct request or based on comments at the public hearing of the Committee of the Whole last month that we include some introductory language about the high standards of Oakbrook. So again, that language was put in there. Transportation and circulation plans and policies. This is a little bit more evident when we get into the sub-area plans. But as indicated, what Jeff was talking about, one of the challenges this time around over 11 years ago was you've had so much success and investment in certain areas of the village in the last decade that it has caused some challenges because of that success. And if you look at sort of the Swift-Windsor area, you look at Blistex has doubled in size, Duchess Wah has come on board, Hub Group has come on board, a new hotel has come on board, you've got a lot of investment in that area of a lot of employees in that area, and traffic is becoming an issue. The capacity of the village's infrastructure system to adequately accommodate the success you have had has now become an issue that needs to be addressed. That's a good example of you're a little bit of a victim of your success, and we have to recalibrate and address that. And a big part of this plan is to make sure that we are a little bit more proactive in areas where development is likely to occur, so we're not sort of behind the curve again. So we talk about the guiding principles for transportation, interstate access. This is a map sort of highlighting or summarizing a lot of the transportation recommendations that are highlighted and discussed in more detail in each one of the sub-area plans. But you can see here, we talk about proposed new trail connections, existing trails, new intersection improvements, underpasses. We identify the underpass. We identify the Harger Road intersection improvement that was sort of coming online as the process was being started. But as Jeff Kennedy indicated, this plan in every area emphasizes the need for enhanced mobility, access, and circulation. Vehicularly and primarily in terms of bicycle and pedestrian. When we spoke with members of the Enhancement Committee, when we spoke with members of the Greater Oak Brook Chamber of Commerce, when we had one-on-one and small group discussions at the Village Hall with businesses from the area, almost all of them articulated the need to better accommodate safe pedestrian mobility in the area, both walking and biking. And many cited examples of employees at their facilities that attempt to walk and bike. Some continue to do so, some had given up because it got too difficult, and those that continue to do it talk routinely about it's not an easy place to walk around and get around. So, and it's also becoming an essential component of where employers choose to locate and where employees choose to work to get at that lifestyle that Jeff Kennedy was referring to. So enhanced pedestrian mobility is a big part of this document. But we identify several things, from intersections, vehicular trails, paced bus routes, you name it, and potential new signals. It's all on here. I'm not going to go through it in detail. We also look at the primary roadway access and configuration, and we look at your average daily traffic counts and the level of service currently right now, and some of the comments on how to begin to improve these roadways. We comment heavily in pedestrian circulation, the need to better access transit, and then other transportation recommendations. Again, these are all brought together in this one chapter, but they are also highlighted in the sub-area plans. So again, a key focus of this was to divide the corridor into sub-areas. If we were to come up with just one set of recommendations for the whole area, what's going to work for Oak Brook Center is not going to work for the small uses on Midwest. They just won't. So we had to break the area down into these eight different areas. So the West End, here, the Midwest area here. Oak Brook Center is in blue. Commerce Drive right here next to Oak Brook Center. Enterprise Drive, which is one of the more unique sub-areas in the village. York and Windsor, this is sort of the hot tamale of a lot of issues right now that we had to deal with in terms of infrastructure. Jory Road Boulevard, or Jory Boulevard right here. And again, the McDonald's Fields site, because of things that have changed on the ground in just the last few weeks slash months, has changed some of the dynamic of discussion down there. And the McDonald's corporate campus site here. When we did this study 11 years ago, we were charged with looking at all the commercial areas in Oak Brook except the McDonald's-owned properties. The idea of thinking, they're not going anywhere, so we don't need to look at them. They do a nice job with their properties. Advanced a decade later, we now had to look at these properties because McDonald's is indeed no longer here. So that has brought this property into play, the Fields property into play, the Plaza site, and the building here. Whereas last time around, we really weren't charged with looking at those. So we'll start with the West End, and I'll sort of walk you through how each one of these is set up. For each one of these, we identify potential opportunity sites, all right? Sometimes when you get into planning, you have to play a little bit of the what-if game. What if these guys go away and the site redevelops? Or what if these people stay, but they want to be part of a redevelopment of the property they own? So we take a look at the properties that we think are the most likely candidates for redevelopment and talk about the redevelopment potential of these properties and considerations the village should take into account when considering potential redevelopment of these areas. So for each one of these sub-areas, we highlight what we are calling opportunity sites. We're not saying you have to redevelopment. We're not saying if it redevelops, you have to do it this way. We're identifying these as opportunity sites to get the village thinking about how they might want to handle these if development were to be proposed. And so here we have three different opportunity sites along the south side here of Butterfield Road. So you can see here, this is the, I'm trying to find here right now, the But this includes Costco, and includes like room and board, and includes all the uses that are down on the western edge of the corridor study area. We then take a look at transportation recommendations. So we look at redevelopment opportunity sites, intersection improvements for pedestrian safety and appearance, landscaping and screening of individual sites. That's the light green dots that you see here. Proposed trail connections for bicycle and pedestrian connectivity, connecting to trails that exist in the area. Proposed sidewalk connectivity. So there's a sidewalk on the edge of pavement where there are gaps right now that people can't walk around. Primary roadways, roadway tollway ramps, potential in the future. Cross access of adjacent properties where cross access doesn't exist. Existing traffic signals, and then proposed traffic signals. So each one of the corridor sections is broken down with these components. Here's Midwest to Kingery. Again, you can see here a large part of this here. Here's Costco here, excuse me. This is the Macy's Furniture Store. This is the potential site for a fire station location here, which is what that states. And then these are some of the uses, potential redevelopment on how they can begin to improve this area of smaller parcels up on Midwest. And again, we go back to sidewalk connectivity to increase pedestrian mobility, screening, and again, sidewalks improvements. This is the Oak Brook Center area. I know since this has come out in the last month or so, I think Oak Brook has submitted a letter to the village identifying some changes they would like to see made as part of the plan as well. They were at every meeting we had just about, and we incorporated comments throughout. But I think now that they've seen it, they've got some additional things that they can present or we can talk about later. But again, it talks about pushing some of the uses out to the edges, bringing some of the parking lots offline and charging up with different uses, beginning to identify redevelopment sites. One of the things that you can state here, this is a Sears Automotive that's being redeveloped. This is a Sears store, it's being redeveloped. And these are potential development opportunity sites sort of over here on Spring Road near the corner of 16th right here. And one of the things we note is that this intersection, if any development here is even considered, before it's considered or as part of considering it, that intersection has got to be improved. It's inadequate now, and if anything more intensely happens in this area, that intersection has to be addressed. So those are some of the things that we've addressed here, as well as pedestrian connectivity all the way across. Right now you can't, as well as cross connectivity on the south side and pedestrian enhancements across 22nd Street. We know there are some streetscape challenges for 83 because Oak Brook Terrace owns jurisdiction of 83 on both sides here. So that makes some challenges for what we can do on the Oak Brook Center side of 83. Commerce Drive is sort of a unique little area here. That you can see here. This is right next to Oak Brook Center. We've identified redevelopment opportunity sites. This is the McDonald's Plaza, the McDonald's headquarters site. This was one of the key changes over the plan we did 11 years ago. We didn't look at redevelopment of that site then because it was not a potential. Now it is. So we look at cross connectivity, redevelopment, other key locations, transportation improvements, and screening improvements and sidewalk improvements. One of the things we did for this site was to come up with a redevelopment concept or an illustrative concept. So there's two illustrative concepts in the plan. There's this one and there's the one for McDonald's Fields property. They're not redevelopment or development programs. These are not recommended site plans. This is not what you should do with the property, but we were charged with sort of identifying redevelopment opportunities. This is clearly a redevelopment opportunity. McDonald's is selling their property. Jones Lang LaSalle was retained by McDonald's to do some investigative work on all their properties to reposition it internationally for re-tenanting and redevelopment. We met with McDonald's, we met with Jones Lang LaSalle on a couple of different occasions, more than a couple of different occasions, and talked to them on the phone and met here at Village Hall with staff and some officials in those discussions as well to hear what they had in mind. They were proposing, or they had some concepts initially for something significantly more intense than this, but their idea that they had was to position this area as mixed use. And this is something that was consistent with mixed use designation in the area on our plan as well. So this is an illustrative concept to show with this entire area. This is the steakhouse that's gonna remain. We expanded it a little bit. I think right now it's this big. So this shows it a little bit bigger with more parking in the back. But this shows what an illustrative development concept could be like for this area. there's an infinite number of possibilities on how this could be developed. It's impossible to articulate or to illustrate what the recommended one should be unless you control the property and you are proposing a development. The idea we wanted to get across was what multi-story mixed use might look like in this area. So this could very well be a hotel. These could be professional offices. Maybe this tower here is residential condominiums. It could be a combination of different uses. We want to work in harmony with the giant employment center that is around it and the entertainment and recreational use that is Oak Brook Center right across Spring Road. But we wanted to demonstrate the potential of this area. To have a site this large, this available, in this location, with proximity to these amenities, is truly one of a kind in the western suburbs, almost in the Chicago regional area. So it's going to demand a pretty creative approach. This is beginning to visualize what mixed use could be like. But again, the language stipulates very clearly, this is not a recommended site plan. This is for illustrative purposes to show what could go here. The good thing about this is it's to scale. So these parking areas are to scale to these buildings, to these landscape areas, to these detention areas. Again, it could manifest in several different ways, but if this is structured parking in a lot of these office buildings, this is a realistic version of what could be in terms of volumetrics. Enterprise Drive, again, is probably one of the most unique areas. This is a cul-de-sac with largely pretty small, significantly small parcels for the most part that go back in here. I would say that compared to every other sub-area, almost this entire sub-area is a redevelopment potential, given the value location here and the built form of a lot of the properties on here. So we identified on here the sites that could be redevelopment priority. A portion of this area is the sort of the research or business park, and other areas are sort of mixed use. This is the most complex one, so let me sort of unpack it a little bit for you. This is the York and Windsor. To give you a little bit of idea, this is Duchossois. Easy building footprint to pick out almost anywhere. You've got Hub Group. You've got the hospital, you've got Blistex now doubled in size. So we've identified in here, you've got Clearwater. Clearwater, by the way, was the first mixed-use development proposed and approved in Oak Brook. Shortly after it was approved, the market sort of went sideways or went down, and the residential component was never built back at the time when the other pieces began to come online. So it was partially built, but never built to what was approved by the village. We identified other redevelopment opportunities here to piggyback on the momentum you already see. The biggest challenge in here is transportation infrastructure. And when all the employees from all this growing area and successful area begins to unload, it's all coming down Windsor to this point. And Windsor's width and capacity is substandard. Swift's width and capacity is substandard for what's going on there and what has developed there over time. Ideally, a connection to Clearwater with the intersection on York would have been the ideal situation. When the hospital came on board, that was not provided. So right now, people come down here to Windsor and go over. I still think in the future, examination ought to be given to looking at Clearwater as a public road, controlled intersection on York, reconnecting Windsor to York. We make that recommendation. In lieu of that happening, we highlight other areas that need to be improved, primarily the width and capacity of Windsor and Swift and the intersection at Windsor and 22nd Street, as well as the other intersections up and down York. There's no one perfect solution for traffic here, but what we're hoping to have happen, and we've taken a look at this, is in lieu of Clearwater coming online, the first thing then you do is look at all the other ways that can begin to ease the burden of this area. A big part of this is potentially a slip ramp on the 294 South, right by the existing on-ramp, slip ramp. If that can get tucked in, the intersection improvements and signalization of Harger is a huge, huge benefit. Right now, people go past this, go up here, turn around, and come back down to get on Harger to access the highway. So this will be a huge traffic flow improvement. Slip ramp will be a huge traffic flow improvement. Dual lefts out of here, and this intersection being widened and improved with enhanced signalization, as well as Windsor being widened and Swift being widened, all these things begin to improve the traffic challenge of this area. If it's not enough over time, you would likely have to come back and re-examine the Clearwater becoming a public road. But right now, we just call it out as something to be done in the future. So we identify here redevelopment opportunity sites, gateway improvements, intersection improvements, right-of-way enhancements and improvements, as well as redevelopment and trail connections and connectivity. Jory Boulevard is the next one. Jory Boulevard, again, a pretty unique situation with the office areas you have back in through here. This is a McDonald's property right over here. It was, that'll be re-tenanted as just another office building. They may have some parking issues with regard to needing a deck or something, depending on what uses go in there. The biggest issue here is the McDonald's field site. So I'll sort of get at a little bit of what we were talking about here as this developed. Throughout the process, nobody articulated, let's keep it as park, in any of the committees or anything like that. And I think part of the challenge was, or part of the reasons was, in a planning document, if you designate private property as public open space, you deny that private property owner any return on their property. You're basically saying you can do nothing with your property, it's gotta be grass, all right? You can only do that if you compensate that property owner. Well, it's a taking, and I'll let the attorneys jump in here, but I've dealt with this enough. So if the plan were to initially come out here and say, okay, McDonald's is gonna sell this property on the private market, and someone buys it to develop it, the village is in a hard position to come in and say, sorry, this is designated as park. You can't do anything with it. It would devalue the property so much, you would have to compensate McDonald's or the new owner for it. So we looked at office, not a good location for office, given other proximity to other office in the area that has more investment, more momentum, better location, better visibility, and the amount of office you have available for development. The idea of like a research park or commercial, again, commercial viability here was almost nil because of the competition that you have in a much better location on 22nd Street, just to the north of here, retail or some sort of commercial venue here, there was no market for it. But there was a market and there is a general appropriateness here for residential. So we took a look at it and we showed what a residential development could be like. And that's this one. Now, when our guys in the office first did it, they were sort of showing if this is sort of maxed out, what could accommodate? We've since backed off of that. This is just a development concept. It's not a development program. There are no numbers or unit counts associated with this or parking units. It says that it could be a 3-to-4-story condominium or townhouse development. It doesn't give a unit count, but it sort of shows how a development could be, again, a development could be located here, taking advantage of orientation to the open space and being buffered from the offices that are on the other side of Kensington. So the idea here was to show an illustrative rendering of the type of development that could go here. And it's labeled as such an illustrative concept. There are no numbers, there are no specific densities. It's a multifamily, and then the text says multifamily or single family attached. Now, since then, as you all know, the Park District put out a referendum to acquire the property. I also understand that McDonald's has a pending contract with the townhouse developer. I don't know the status of that, not been asked the status of that. But the referendum passed, I read the papers, referendum passed by a margin of 2-to-1, which means now if the property owner is willing to sell it, it appears as though the village or the Park District has the money to buy it and keep it as open space, which is why it wasn't designated as open space the first space time, because you would have to have then, if the plan said open space, the village said zone it open space, you would then have to buy it because you're depriving them of any development potential. So now that the village or the Park District has the funds to do so, then it's between the Park District, the village, and the McDonald's, or who the current contract owner is. So this could very well be parks and open space, which would be fine. And this is, I think, was important to say, based on the information we have at the time plans were developed, we developed a plan and put the best foot forward, given market realities, legal maneuvering in terms of positioning and what you can and can't do to someone's private property, and to leverage appropriate development concepts or land use designations within the context of the greater Oak Brook area. If this were to be designated because of the Park District resolution and you could work out a deal with McDonald's or the contract purchaser and be open space or park, that's great. It's an easy change to make in the plan. You just delete all those buildings and put grass there or fields or whatever. It could be a phenomenal open space facility. So if that is the direction the plan ends up going, all for it. If it's not gonna go open space, it has to be shown as some sort of developable land. Residential of some kind is, I think, professionally the most appropriate type of development for this location. if it is not going to be open space. I don't think it's as viable or appropriate for it to be commercial or office or business research park or anything else at this location. And one of the interesting things I thought when we first met with the village board, not at the committee of the whole, but a couple months before that, was village president sort of went down the row and each person sort of commented, and I was making notes. A couple said they liked the concept plan of condominiums on the site. Some said they were open to multifamily, but only if it was townhomes. One said townhomes only if it was low-density townhomes. One said, I want, if it's residential, large lot, single family, detached. And then I think one person at that point said, well, what if, can't it just stay open space? So if you went down the line of trustees as they spoke at that meeting, there wasn't consensus from any one of them as to what type of residential it should be. It varied across the full spectrum. So if the village can work out the fact that it stay open space, I think that's great. If they can't, I'm professionally recommending that this be a residential development of some kind. This identifies a concept. It articulates a condominium or a townhouse development. I don't think it's appropriate for single family detached large lot, but a condominium development or a townhouse development at varying densities could be appropriate in a million different manifestations. So residential, if the park doesn't happen, if the park happens, that's a great use for this as well. But we can't show it as park if park's not a viable option, and funding is the viability of that option. The last piece is the McDonald's corporate campus. And I think when we first were charged with this, a lot of people were sort of salivating at what this could be. And then throughout the process, we started to hear that it probably should be primarily left alone. This was echoed by residents at the committee of the whole meeting when the public commented. This was echoed. Jones Lang LaSalle and McDonald's own internal investigation said that's the best positioning for the property is to leave it the way it is and re-tenant the office buildings. You don't want to come in here and start redeveloping this property with the open space, the wetlands, the biodiversity, the trails. The last thing you want to do is go in there and start messing it up and putting in more intense development. I think one of the most compelling and articulate commentaries at the last committee of the whole meeting, and if it's recording, go watch it, was Joe Antunovich, who was the architect who did this. And he goes, and I may get this quote wrong, but he goes, I remember walking this property with Ray Kroc. And he goes, we spent hours walking. He goes, it was stunningly beautiful. And he goes, we painfully put together a campus master plan. And he goes, I think, and he knew exactly how many trees were on here, what kind and how big. And he goes, it pained us because we had to remove three of those trees. So they did what they did, removing almost no trees, and it was designed within that gorgeous campus. So they came to the conclusion and recommendation internally, the same conclusion we came to, and it was echoed by several residents who spoke throughout the process and in the committee, the whole meeting. This is a beautiful campus. This is a hallmark, a calling card of Oak Brook and the quality and character and high standards of the village. So even though something is a development opportunity, doesn't mean you need to take the opportunity to develop. And this is one of those cases. So what we are recommending as part of this is before redevelopment plans are beginning to draw or conceptually be developed, that we give it legitimate time to give it a shot to re-tenant the existing buildings onto this campus. Whether one development is able to come in or one owner is able to come in and occupy at McDonald's, fantastic. Whether it's one tenant per building or multiple tenants per building, if you had to work in a suburban office park, you can't come up with a nicer one than this. So our recommendation is that it's an opportunity that should not be seized upon for redevelopment. And then we should show the restraint and discipline to leave this what it is, which is a beautiful hallmark enjoyed by not only the corporate residents here, but by the residents who fish here, walk here, bike here, birdwatch here. It's gorgeous. So our recommendation to the plan is to not alter this campus. But again, go back and watch the video of Joe's presentation. I'm starting to wrap my head around walking a beautiful setting with Ray Kroc and deciding how to develop a site without trees. Or without taking down any trees. So the recommendation for this site, and again, at the beginning of the process, I think there was a lot of anticipation of a really creative redevelopment plan here, but we think it was the exact wrong approach, and what we did was to leave it the way it is. We do require or talk about some enhancements around the periphery and the roadways. We did talk with representation of the hotel In fact, several of the meetings we had were at the hotel, they said, McDonald's is going to go, someone else will come, we're not going anywhere. We will be open. We're booking stuff already 2 years in advance. So the hotel had committed to us at those meetings that they had every intention of remaining on site as a hotel. So again, that's probably a longer presentation of the plan than you wanted, but I think it's important to walk through what it is. I can't articulate the context or the importance of this plan better than Jeff Kennedy did. This village has seen an incredible amount of success over the last decade, exactly during a decade where other villages saw virtually no success. A plan like this is a playbook. You can be really busy over the course of a decade, and you can just be killing yourself, occupying your time, and you can look back and say, man, we've been so busy, and we look back, and we're where we are now. We were 10 years ago. Or you can say, man, we've been working really hard. We're all lockstep, moving toward the same direction. It's been a decade, and man, look what we've accomplished. And that's exactly Oak Brook's story. So to Jeff's point, this is a time to recalibrate where we have to and to begin to reposition for the next decade of growth and investment to set the regional mark that other communities are trying still to meet when they haven't received the investment that Oak Brook has been seeing. So this plan does that. Open to any comments, obviously. This is open for discussion. It is a draft. We think our positioning of these properties is exactly consistent with trends not only across the region, but across the country. Injecting a modest amount of residential development into mixed commercial corridors is the recipe for success in dynamic shopping districts. You can talk to anybody in retail. The notion is experiential retail. Shopping, dining, entertainment, culture, retail, restaurant, service, residential is now an essential part of that mix. So we've identified the locations where we think it is most appropriate to see some residential come out of the ground. And again, it's less mixed use now than it was proposed 11 years ago, not more. So with that, thank you so much. That is sort of an overview of the document. And as we get into the evening, I can answer any questions that comes up. So thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. At this juncture, I'd like to open comments and questions to the audience. Gail has a list, and she'll call each person to come to the podium in order that they signed in. And when you do come to the podium, if you could state your name and address for the record, would be appreciated. Okay. All right.
Okay, first,
Fred Capetta.
Fred, before you start, have you been sworn in?
I was. I did.
Thank you.
And while I sat there, I changed my presentation. I was overwhelmed. I thought Jeff's presentation was wonderful. Mr. Housel, who's an expert, his presentation was wonderful. So many plans, so many efforts have been put into this. I don't want to disrupt them. I have some disagreement in some places. I want you to be aware of it because I think you have a far greater role than looking at whether the park district should be there or whether this building should be there or that development should be there. You are the beginning of what really happens. I've owned property in this community for 45 years. I moved my family here 40 years ago. I have a home. I live on Frederick Drive. I've raised my family here. I've practiced law for 50 years, 35 of them. In the village of Oak Brook. In Cook County, I practice in all the collar counties. I've been in all six or seven of them. So I've seen a lot of development. I've seen a lot of boards. And I don't want you to get misdirected. They've done a wonderful job. I wish this was a comprehensive plan. My concern is mostly about what conflict will people see, lawyers, those people see, in the development and your commercial revitalization plan and your comprehensive plan. I see contradictions, and I'm concerned. That's how I make a living. That's how lawyers make a living. I'd like it to be a symphony, not just a little band over here and a little band over there, and I pick up a sentence here and then I criticize what's over there, pick up a sentence over there and criticize what's here. You're at the heart of what can be done. You, the Plan Commission, you, the ZBA, you, the Village Board, you now have the power to make sure that you have a cohesive plan. Make sure these things come together and are treated as a single. Don't have them be inconsistent. Don't leave an edge so an improper developer comes in and uses that edge. Jeff Kennedy said so smartly and so rightly, the development in the community comes from the developers. The village isn't investing money. No one's investing money in this but the developers. And you want to plant a fertile soil so that you get the right developers here. People are going to put hundreds of millions of dollars into your property, and we're going to be the beneficiaries of that development. So they need a plan. Your plan has to be masterful. Don't get down in the nitty-gritty. Don't get down in, is the park district going to buy? Is this one going to buy? Well, you know, Pulte might have this, and we ought... You don't care about any of that. You should have a plan. You should decide what it is you want for this area, and then you're going to find good people like Pulte and the Fasano and all those people who want to come and bring big money, Heinz, whoever it is, they're going to come and bring big money to you. If you have a cohesive plan that makes sense to you, that's where you should be. Stay away from getting into the nitty-gritty. I don't like that they made Kensington residential. As much as I respect Mr. Housel, I see that as a violation of the districts. That's just, I don't know that it should be open. I don't care whether the park district buys it or not. That's going to be up to the seller. That's not up to you. That's up to McDonald's. You know, the fact that they've got the money to buy it doesn't prove that McDonald's is going to sell it to them. That's not what you're about. You should keep this in a way so that some developer looks at it when it's available, when the right owner sells it and the right developer buys it, someone who's willing to invest in our community, that the development is what's going to be to our benefit. So I really would like you to step back and don't get dragged down into the little nitty-gritty fighting with me and the other lawyers and anybody else who's got something in this. This is all about doing it right. So I look at that Kensington piece and I say, you know, you had this problem once before. You let Forest Gate build, and then the park district put up a baseball field and the lights were too bright and they went, move the lights here, move. That's what you do when you introduce residential into an area. You got the park district competing. Now you're telling me you're going to put if the park district is unsuccessful, you're going to put residential there. Now we're going to move the lights to the other side now and have the people at Forest Gate complain. Zoning is by district. Don't come up, I've got a plan, I've got a developer, he's got a good idea for this piece. You should have zones and districts, and you should respect them very, very carefully. Leave to your competent plan commission, your competent zoning board of appeals, your competent, whatever it's called, what is it called? Help me, Rebecca.
Plan development
committee. Leave those people the latitude to work within that district. Yeah, multi-use is great, but don't designate that residential's got to be here. You're changing a district when you do that in your commercial revitalization plan. Mr. Housel maybe has a better way. Maybe he can explain it to me at another time. But somehow, that's the kind of little mistake I see as an opportunity for the wrong thing to happen. So I really would implore you to pay attention, keep it open, keep it general, respect zoning districts. Don't get it all chopped up and leave it a mess. Leave it in a condition so that a good developer sees a good opportunity, comes and invests $100 million for us in our community, and that we can treat that development and that property properly. If a condominium's proper, leave that to the ZBA and this commission to recommend it to a competent board and let them make the decision on that. Don't try to make all of those little itty-bitty decisions and then get us a plan that's impossible to work with and leave yourself a lot of future problems and a lot of life, difficult life with lawyers beating on you. Rebecca, you're smiling at me. Does that mean my 3 minutes is up? Anyway, so you didn't hear the speech I wanted to give you. You heard what I was thinking. Speech I wanted to give you, I've given you before. That's districts. Remember, it's all about districts. Don't get involved in this developer is going to offer this and I'm going to zone it. You decide where it should be, what the district should be, and you find, and let a good developer then say he's got a way to come here. He's pointed out you've got some real gems here. You've got the sports car. You've got this McDonald's property. You got these wonderful jewels. Don't mess them up with all this little thinking about, well, you know, Mr. Pulte wants to put up apartments here, and I'm against him. Should you have that there? Housel says yes. Capetta says no. It doesn't make any difference. You're responsible for it. You decide what your districts are, what makes the most sense. Dictate it. Housel will live with it. Capetta will live with it. And new developers will have to live with it. So he's not always right. I might be. I'm older than he is. I want to thank you very much.
Thank you.
David Beard.
Mr. Beard, you've been sworn in.
Yes, I have.
Thank you.
Yes, ma'am. I'm David Beard, 8 Croydon Lane in Oak Brook, and that's the Yorkwood subdivision. And I haven't really been following too much of what's been going on with the Planning Commission, but I did read the plan, and I did understand the presentation tonight. My wife and I and daughter moved here in 2007, and before that, my wife was grew up here in at 11 Croydon, went to Butler Middle School, and attended Hinsdale Central, graduated. So we have good roots here. Her parents also lived here. And this is actually the first community that we've actually wanted to live in, as opposed to having to live in. So we love being here. And as a result of that, we have a little bit of input into some of the issues. In particular, my comments are about the plan that we talked about with regards to the Kensington Fields. And just briefly, a few ideas to consider when approving this. The residential development right next to Kingerley Highway might be a question with regards to noise abatement and so on. I just don't see luxury use and luxury demand in an area that close to the highway. So again, I agree it's interim in a draft plan, but that could be an issue if you're trying to attract luxury market. And this plan is about dealing with commercial growth and improvement. And I was frankly surprised that it actually added a new residential component. And I understand the reason for that. However, that wasn't what I was expected to see a whole new residential unit being added in a commercial plan like this. Okay, one of the purposes of a plan like this is to improve traffic flows. And so it's a question in my mind, really, how we can take an entire new residential unit, residential subdivision, without making drastic improvements to the transportation infrastructure first. And there's other infrastructure involved besides traffic, but I just cite that one as an easy one everyone can relate to and has been brought up many times. And lastly, and most importantly, based on results of the referendum and all the feedback you've heard so far, I really believe there's a lot of people who are residents in this community, longtime residents, who would like you to approve this plan without the residential suggestion of the Kensington Fields in the same manner as the McDonald's campus being so much in flux that we really don't know the outcome of this commercial deal with McDonald's right now. It may be too early to suggest that residential development is imminent and giving developers the impression that's a done deal, because it's really not, like has been brought up before. I believe our destiny is somewhat in our hands, that developers do not run Oak Brook. Developers have a say, but they're only interested in their project. They're only interested in their short-term gains. And I have lived in many PUDs that have been started from scratch, and we have been part of many turnovers where the developer has left and the character of the neighborhood changed dramatically. So from personal experience, I have seen how when developers build and they're done, all of a sudden we're left trying to figure out everything that should have been done differently. So I'm just suggesting that we proceed cautiously with developer input, that it's not all about money. It's about lifestyle. It's about what is the character of Oak Brook. Maybe we don't need to come up to speed so quickly on multifamily as they say we need to. Thank you.
Thank you.
Excuse me. Thank you. Laura Suleiman.
Laura, have you been sworn in?
I have.
Thank you.
Can you hear me? Great. I'll make my comments very brief. Again, my name is Lara Suleiman. I have been a six-year resident of Oak Brook. I moved from Willowbrook, and the area right where I moved from is now battling the Sterigenics battle, so it's quite a contested area right now. But I'd like to say that I'm very proud of a background in marketing and journalism. I'm also a very strong advocate of open land, recreation, and also exemplary education, and that's why we moved to this school district. I'm very involved in the educational aspect of Oak Brook and also of recreation, especially I'm a very big advocate of the Park District. Why I'm talking today, or what my comments are, basically about the McDonald's fields. And I am, again, a staunch advocate of open land. And this concept that we have right now, the commercial revitalization concept, comes from the word revitalize. Vital means living, and open land comes from nature. And not to sound cheesy or anything like that, but vitality is living. And we want to preserve that nature. And we don't want to suffocate our community. We value it. The Butler tradition values open land. And I believe the referendum said that in high numbers, that our community, especially the senior community, values open land, and we want to value their opinion. And I believe the referendum said that very strongly, and it almost, in a sense, disrespects the power of those numbers. Why I say that McDonald's Fields is important is because how we are revitalizing Oak Brook, which I respect very much with this plan, we also can revitalize the concepts of open land, meaning that we could market that land very well to invite revenue into Oak Brook in different ways. It requires more work, it requires creativity, but there's no way that we can say that bringing the hotels involved and restaurants involved, the Park District, for example, or surrounding areas, bringing them all to this open land and creating and generating revenue in a concept that is quite unbelievable. We're talking Ravinia, we're talking open movies, we're talking yoga on the lawn, anything you want, we can think outside of the box. Now, I understand in listening to the previous presenters, they talked about not zoning it in a particular way or not making it look like open land. I feel that's confusing. You either have it as open land or you don't. You can if you don't want to have it as recreational use, keep it as commercial with special use permit. But the voters went to the ballot saying that it's open land, and that's what they want. So I think it's very confusing. We have to have a general plan like the previous two speakers had. We don't have to get into the nitty-gritty, but we also have to be very clear about what vision Oak Brook has. So as residents, as people like me that value recreation, we can be creative about that land. At the same time, bring revenue to Oak Brook. Again, I respect this plan. I love Oak Brook, and I'm passionate about Oak Brook, and I'm willing to work to create a plan that keeps the pride and the vitality of this community, but I also don't want to see it suffocate. We have come here, and we've sacrificed our families and our well-being to live in this community, and I'd really like to see it thrive and have everybody's stakes in mind. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Sanford.
Mr. Sanford, have you been sworn in?
Yes, I have.
Thank you.
My name is Bob Sanford. I've lived in Oak Brook for over 40 years. I have lived in Brook Forest for well over 30 of those years, was president of the Brook Forest Homeowners Association, was on the zoning board, a trustee, worked on the revitalization program, and was involved in it since its inception. And I am absolutely delighted to follow so many people I agree with. but I wanted to speak in support of the plan. I hope that you don't disregard the plan just because you're not in total agreement with some of the changes that seem to be developing regarding some of the areas within the village. It's definitely possible to modify the plan from an office building to open fields as per the Park District referendum and still keep the fundamentals of the plan. The plan is a guide, and it's not fixed in stone. The plan's a starting point that can be modified, but at least it's a plan that we have an opportunity to build on. So I'm glad I could keep this short, and thank you for your time. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Larry Herman.
Mr. Herman, have you been sworn in?
I have.
Thank you.
Thank you. Larry Herman, 413 Luthen Road. Like many people in the room, I have been a longtime resident, nearly 50-year resident with my family in Oak Brook. Our family business has been in the commercial part of Oak Brook for nearly 50 years, and I've been a commercial property owner in Oak Brook for nearly 25 years. So yes, as a commercial property owner, I presumably have a financial interest in the outcome of this plan. But as a resident, and particularly as a passionate longtime resident, I also have a financial interest in the vitality and continued vitality of what happens in Oak Brook and the commercial areas. I've been following what's been going on with this discussion. I've been to some of the meetings. I've certainly watched on tape. I've read some of the reports. And it seems to me that there's been a lot of comments in prior forums from many other longtime residents that seem to me to suggest that we have to be careful that Oak Brook kind of stay the way it's always been. And I certainly am an advocate for being especially respectful of our historic residential neighborhoods and making sure that we are very careful not to disturb the character of those neighborhoods. But I think we all, you know, there seems to be a lot of people that get up and everyone seems to be an expert or have an opinion on what Paul Butler would have wanted, what Paul Butler thought. And of course, they're all different. So, you know, I think we have to be continually progressive about our commercial areas, and that does not mean impacting our residential areas, except for traffic, which I'll comment on in a minute. There's been a lot of discussion about multifamily housing. My personal opinion, and I totally agree with Jeff Kennedy, is times change and people's tastes change, and whether you're a millennial or whether or not you're a senior, a lot of people want multifamily these days, and townhomes are not the answer for everyone. If you go downtown or even some of the communities, vertical housing, upscale vertical housing is what a lot of people want. And I know there's some concerns that we don't start looking like Oak Park or we don't start looking like some of the projects in downtown LaGrange, for example. But we can do it tastefully and we can do it in areas where it's appropriate. I recognize that some of the projects that are currently on the drawing board, the scale may not be appropriate, the locations may not be appropriate, but that doesn't mean that we shouldn't have vertical multifamily housing in this town. There is a demand for it, and there's a demand for it from the types of people we'd like to have as neighbors. The other thing that strikes me is there's been a lot of criticism about the idea that we should even mention the idea of rental housing in Oak Brook. Well, a lot of these same people who want vertical housing, millennials and so forth, they don't want to own either. And there's nothing, dirty about, high-end multifamily residents. Rental residences. It's in this town, it seems to be about as dirty a word as home rule. So I think we should keep that in mind as we develop. And especially, if we want, we have a lot of people have been living in this village for a long time, who are living in houses, they've been there for decades, and we want vitality in our residential areas, but, people have nowhere to go, they're not moving out. Let's create places where they can go so we can empty houses and invite young families that will bring a lot of vibrancy into our residential areas. So I want to commend the committee and Jeff Kennedy and Hauser Levine for the great work they've done. Like a lot of other people, nothing's perfect. There's things about the plan that maybe need refinement. One of the last areas I want to comment on is the notion of traffic. As a longtime resident, along with our commissioner Tom Doyle, living on the south end of York Road, I can tell you the traffic there has been horrendous for years during rush hour, morning rush and evening rush. It's only getting worse. If you try driving at 5 o'clock southbound on York Road. The traffic backs up all the way from York and Ogden all the way to Butler School. It can take you, you know, in non-traffic, I can get from my house to my office in less than 2 minutes. In rush hour traffic, it can take 20 minutes to get home. And most of that is all southbound tollway traffic. So the slip ramp that was modeled in here for off the Clearwater area, that should not be an afterthought. That's got to be critically important to anything we do in the village. I don't know what the engineering of that is like, but that is just absolutely essential. And it's not only crowded on South York Road, it becomes very dangerous. Those are residential areas there. It's a residential road. And it's a very dangerous area. So again, thank you and kudos to all the people who have done great work on this.
Thank you.
I apologize if I get this wrong. Gita Kulkum. Okay, I'll let you say it.
Have you been sworn in?
No, I haven't, I'm sorry.
Okay. If you'd raise your right hand, please. Do you swear or affirm that the testimony you are about to give at this hearing will be the truth?
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you.
Okay. Just 1 second. Hi, everyone. My name is Geeta Kulkarni, and I live in Brook Forest. I am a 11-year resident of Oak Brook. Just a few things I would like to call out specifically with regard to the McDonald's fields. If you want condos, all you have to do is drive around the suburban surrounding neighborhoods and villages, and you will see plenty of condo development. We do not need the same in Oak Brook. Having condos specifically on this property is not going to ensure, as our consultant here pointed out, that people get to walk to their work or walk to the mall. You're not going to be, you know, all of the people living in those condos are not necessarily going to be walking to their work. Not everyone would be working across the street from there. I would also like to point out that transportation will get worse for sure, not better. I wonder also whether our esteemed consultant here has ever driven on 34th Street during rush hour traffic. It was also pointed out that pedestrian mobility would be enhanced, and I'm sorry, but I beg to differ on that point also. As I was coming for this meeting, my 12-year-old son heard me tell my husband that I'm coming here, and he wanted me to pass on a message to this board and to all of the attendees. He said that he loves being in Oak Brook, and he would like to see more green space and more play areas. Our kids are listening, and they are talking, and frankly, they are concerned for their own future. Please remember your duty to the future generations. I'm really astounded that we would even consider a plan like this, given that most residents have strongly stated that their desire is to keep Oak Brook clean, green, and beautiful. I think we should take another look at this whole plan, maybe by bringing in another consultant and, you know, taking a look and looking at what people's wishes are to keep Oak Brook, as I said, clean, green, and beautiful. Thank you.
Thank you.
Dennis Hiffman.
Mr. Hiffman, have you been sworn in?
I have been.
Thank you.
My name is Dennis Hiffman. For the record, I'm at 1 Oak Brook Terrace, Suite 400 in Oak Brook Terrace, Illinois. I am not a resident of Oak Brook, but I am a corporate resident. I have been here for 40 years conducting my business. I am the founder and chairman of NAI Hiffman, which is the largest commercial real estate firm in the Midwest. And again, I built the building 40 years ago. I really want to answer a couple of questions, but developers don't come and then leave at 5 o'clock, take the money, and go somewhere else. I've been in it for the long haul here. I built the Northern Trust Bank building. I've been in that building for 40 years, believe it or not, that building's 40 years old. And I have been part of the community in the sense that I'm on the chamber, I'm on their board of directors, and I also was asked to serve on the commercial revitalization plan. So the two points that I really wanted to make were that the members of this commercial revitalization plan were all volunteers, and their efforts were honest efforts to do the best they could to come up with a revitalized plan. People have attacked them as having some other motives, but you will find that, you know, we had residents, we had business community, everybody had a honest input. The other thing about the take the money and run, the developers, again, Jeff and I had talked, it's unscientific, but we're sure that there's more than $1 billion that was put into this village by developers. The village didn't put the money in there, the developers put the money in there. It created an environment for corporations to conduct their business here. The people, they come, they have breakfast in the morning, the employees have lunch, dinner, they shop in the shopping center, they fill the hotels, they are an integral part of what makes this community tick. So there are two parts, there's the residential side and there's the commercial side. So please don't forget that they are integral part. Thank you.
Thank you.
Adam Tritt.
Mr. Tritt, have you been sworn in?
I have.
Thank you.
Good evening. Like Mr. Hiffman, I am not a resident of the village, but a corporate resident. I work with Brookfield Properties here representing Oak Brook Center. Appreciate the opportunity to speak to you tonight. We agree that the plan has been great. I would support the notion that it's spurred something in the magnitude of $1 billion in the village over the last 11 years. We've been a significant part of that. We agree that it's time to update and modernize that. We did reach out and had some meetings with staff over the summer of 2018 and provided some comments in both August and October, some of which I believe are in front of you. I just wanted to stand here tonight and share with all of you that we think it's most important that the revised plan be aligned with the current state of our business, which is very much evolving today. I think a couple of the speakers tonight have referenced the state of the retail marketplace, which is, of course, our primary business, and how that is changing and shifting and moving from a more functional utilitarian environment to a much more experiential environment. And what that means today is very different than what it meant even 5 years ago, and I believe very different than what it will mean come 5 years from now. Over the last 10 years or so that I've been personally involved, we've enjoyed a tremendous spirit of partnership with the village. We've been able to execute a multitude of projects over at Oak Brook Center that have kept the property in alignment with what the village wants to be, with what the industry wants it to be, with what the consumer wants it to be. And we very much look forward to continuing that spirit of partnership and making sure that the plan that gets adopted supports that on a go-forward basis. So I want to thank all of you for your efforts towards that. We appreciate being a part of this. Danielle will speak after me and speak to a few specific points, but really just wanted to thank everybody for the opportunity to participate in the process. Thank you.
Thank you.
Danielle Castle.
Danielle, you've been sworn in.
I have been. Thank you. Gail, which of the icons is, So I believe I've been advised that in your packet are the selected pages from the draft, the October draft plan, where General Growth, now Brookfield, had made some suggested comments and some suggestions.
It's under item D in your packet.
Great. Thank you so much. So I'll skip over just this first comment. This was just a factual thing to correct unless Hawaii secedes. Oak Brook is the largest open-air shopping center in the continental United States, but not the country. Let's keep Hawaii. Okay.
I'm sorry, Danielle. One second. It's under item six. Oh. I suggested D, and I misspoke.
D. Pardon. For Danielle. Okay.
Exactly.
Of the gray file.
Yes.
I know everybody's looking at the big map, but it's actually this gray file.
So as Adam mentioned, we just wanted to highlight a couple of specifics and didn't mean to beat a dead horse, but there really are just three or four comments, but they appear on multiple pages. So we did try in our annotation to be very specific where these three or four comments came up each time. So the second page of the PDF that we had provided that you have happens to be page three of the comprehensive plan. And we just wanted maybe to have the final version of the plan, if you were in agreement, to please clarify a little bit of the description of Oak Brook Center. It's called the largest commercial shopping center within the community and region, but it's very integral to Oak Brook Center and has been for decades, that it is a mixed use, not residential yet, but a mixed use project which has retail and entertainment and office, including vertical components as well. So we had suggested the comment that's bubbled at the bottom that appropriate land uses at Oak Brook Center include elements of each of the village's land use designations other than single family, detached, and attached residential uses. But that sort of introductory concept, I think it's fleshed out better later in later pages. But I do want to note that the second sentence under Oak Brook Center says it is surrounded by other retail and office uses, and really office is integral to Oak Brook Center as it is today. And I think Mr. Hiffman also made this point very well. Office residents, office occupants drive demand for entertainment, the healthcare uses, the retail uses, the dining uses. Just a quick note, and again, this will come up on a couple of other pages, General Growth, now Brookfield. What we actually own and operate as an integrated shopping center includes the section along Spring, where you see our blue arrow ending. And so we just wanted to be clear that this zone should be designated as part of the Oak Brook Center. And also, and again, this will be fleshed out a little bit more in later pages, the mixed use, as Hazia Levine has formulated it in the plan, describes it as vertical development that might have multiple uses in it. Well, we already have vertical mixed-use development inside of Oak Brook. And we were concerned that only that one segment near the hotel on Spring Road was noted for vertical development. I think the 2007 plan, which we all, the village, Oak Brook Center, have all used so successfully, has pointed out all along that the parking lots along 22 are not the most beautiful land use in the world or the most efficient land use. They're surface parking lots. And as we try to plan for the next decade, even the next decades, plural, for Oak Brook Center, and you'll also see this come up later, the idea that there should be more development pushed to 22nd or along 22nd, well, that will have some verticality to it. So I don't think we're suggesting anything that's really different in the plan. I just think we need to be a little more careful to make sure that we're not making an implication that along 22nd, the vertical development would be inappropriate. This happens to correspond to, I think, page 6 of the plan. Guiding principles, we agree with all of them, but the first bullet where it says, reserve highly visible and accessible properties for regional commercial and retail uses, we think complementary mixed uses is an important piece to that concept as well. And then protect the village's residential neighborhood character from commercial encroachment, we couldn't agree more. It's also not, there is no single family residential that's proximate to us. We have obviously the multifamily of Oakbrook to the north. But because we do believe in a future that may very well include vertical residential, the idea that there would be vertical residential but no commercial and vice versa just didn't seem to fit with the mixed use vision. Okay, this is page 8, and we just wanted to point out here this bubbled comment for those who can't read. I know it's as the PDF became a PowerPoint, things got a little fuzzy here. What we wrote was that the continued reinvention and vitality of Oakbrook Center is likely to depend on the ability of the center to create increased density and continue diversifying uses. I mean, that's what we've been doing all for the last decade and very successfully. Let me go to page 9. I don't want to get too far in the weeds, but our comments to this page are essentially noting the importance of how complementary office uses, including medical uses, are with retail's Oakbrook uses. And again, that we don't want to create an implication that office development would be inappropriate within Oakbrook Center's boundaries along the 22nd Street or elsewhere in its perimeter. I'm going to skip over the architectural lighting comment. And I'll skip over this one as well. Just again, the idea that vertical developments may very well integrate multifamily residential with other uses, whether it's convenience retail or other office. And in those cases, there wouldn't be a landscape buffer in between them. Okay, just really our only comments on the residential areas plan and policies, because again, this doesn't really touch the core of Oakbrook Center, was just to note, as we did earlier, that area along Spring near the hotel is part of Oakbrook Center. And we, again, believe that mixed use is appropriate, particularly along the southern portion of the site. You're away from floodplains, you're away from, farther away from Oakbrook Center. There really aren't sensitive uses to buffer that would preclude that type of development along 22nd Street. I'll skip over this page because it would be redundant with the earlier comments. Okay, and last but not least, the page that is really about our sub area. Again, we were starting from left and moving to the right. We were unclear why E was called out. It says opportunity to convert, redevelop existing structure for new adaptive reuse, possibly residential. We were unclear why this particular parcel should be singled out relative to other perimeter areas of the center. And then moving to the top right, again, there are no immediate plans to redevelop, create vertical, introduce residential at Oakbrook Center. None of those are on our horizon yet. But this is a long-term plan for the future, and I think in the lifetime that this plan will be in place and guiding us, we should lay the groundwork and create that flexibility, that control and flexibility, I think was the phrase earlier, to not preclude what the village might decide through the plan development process and otherwise are appropriate mixed-use developments in the future. And then we think that note in yellow, and there it's really gotten fuzzy beyond belief. So what's highlighted in yellow is in the current draft, and it says Oakbrook Center's large setback only showcases unsightly parking areas. The village should encourage mall expansion, which could, and this is in bold, relocate anchor tenants closer to the property lines to showcase attractive buildings and architecture. This improvement would provide additional retail space for the center's owners, improve the appearance of the corridor, and create better opportunities to connect nearby uses to the retail and dining destinations. So there are elements of that quote, of that suggestion, that we entirely agree with, but the future of retail, I think, as we all know, is not going to involve large anchors, new anchors, moved anchors. It's going to be the type of mixed use, multi-use redevelopment that we've begun at the core, and all of those uses may move to the perimeter, or it may prove that we want to keep all of the pedestrian connectivity at the center of the site and do office or residential or whatever the future might bring us at the perimeter, and leave that pedestrian activity and pedestrian basically environment and all of the beautiful green space and open space that we have at the center, leave that intact rather than draw the retail energy out to the perimeter. So I think the last thing I just wanted to point out is the plan development ordinance. So as I think you're all very, very well aware, because of the plan development overlay for the village, you really can't build new buildings at Oakbrook Center without going through the PD process. And there, again, we have no immediate plans whatsoever to introduce residential, to introduce vertical, but in the lifetime of this plan, it's quite likely we would. And even if that is something we would like to do, we would still need to come to the village, go through the very, very detailed plan development process, and go through each of those important substantive and procedural standards that are incorporated into the PD process, and make our case with the burden of proof on us to make the case that any of these individual components or projects or buildings are worthy in your eyes. But there is one thing that's very clear in the PD process, and that is that these future PDs be consistent with the commercial revitalization area plan. The village has the authority through the PD to vary bulk, density, uses, all of those sorts of things. But it does say very clearly and very repetitively, not in a bad way, but many, many times in the PD chapter, that any future buildings will have to be PDs and will have to be consistent with this plan. And that's why we're respectfully asking that the version of this plan that is ultimately approved by the board, and we hope your recommendations to the board will incorporate some or all of what we're talking about. We're just really hoping that the plan doesn't limit those possibilities for the future. Thank you.
Thank you.
David Carlin.
Mr. Carlin, you've been sworn in?
I have not.
Okay. Do you swear or affirm that the testimony you are about to give at this hearing will be the truth?
I do.
Thank you.
Thank you. Chairwoman Trapinski, I apologize. I was sitting there a little while without talking, so I had to get my voice out. Chairwoman and members of the committee, I'd like to thank you for providing me with a few minutes to speak on behalf of the Greater Oakbrook Chamber of Commerce. I'm going to deviate from my planned remarks because there was a number of speakers before me, and I don't want to be repetitious. And in the spirit of Thanksgiving, I'm going to keep my remarks very brief, so we're not here till midnight like I know some of you were last Monday. The Greater Oakbrook Chamber of Commerce Board of Directors did pass a resolution in support of the commercial areas plan and the work that was conducted over a two-year period. the Greater Oak Brook Chamber of Commerce's Economic Development Partnership Council also adopted a resolution in support of the plan. So without any further comment, I would just like to respectfully ask that you move the plan forward to the Board of Trustees for approval. And I know that we're probably going to have a number of additional public hearings. So if that's necessary, if that does occur, I will be ready to provide more detailed input. And I know there's a number of chamber members that would like to as well. But thank you.
Thank you.
That is it.
Okay. At this juncture, we're not going to go to midnight tonight for our meeting. There's a lot of material here to discuss, but I think we still do have a little bit of time. If the commissioners have any questions or concerns that they want to table, you know, we could try and sort through some of them. But I would like to table some of any issues that you may have so that we can bring them at the next meeting. So at this juncture, any of the commissioners want to start? Do they have any specific questions?
The only question I had, which was really regarding the soccer field, was trying to understand if we're defining density at all there if, when we're putting residential. And I was just trying to find out if that was medium. I think it explained medium density. I was just trying to understand if it's townhouses, is that considered medium density?
Different communities will define, usually in their ordinances or their plans, what low, medium, estate residential, high density is. Some do, some don't. The concept in here states a condominium or townhouse development of varying density. So it doesn't dictate high, medium, low. It just sort of says the concept demonstrates this is an appropriate location for a residential development. Could be condominiums, could be townhomes. It does not articulate low density, which would be single family detached. So I guess you would say medium density if it's considering townhomes, yeah.
The other similar developments with townhouses are, I think those are Briarwood and is it Forescape? We were talking about that a little bit. Those are considered low density, right?
Go ahead.
Yeah, we talked this afternoon, and I'm assuming we just want to get the info out there. But yeah, real quick, there's three multifamily developments in town, two of which are Briarwood Lakes and Forest Gate. And just from a density perspective, Briarwood Lakes is 2.93 dwelling units per acre. Forest Gate is approximately 2.30 dwelling units per acre. And then Oak Brook Club, which is about 13.1 dwelling units per acre. And just to kind of put that into perspective, the Pulte proposal that we've seen one concept plan for at this point in time, just a concept plan, it has not gone through any process. Their 169 unit townhome development on 34 acres is 4.97 dwelling units per acre. So significantly less than Oak Brook Club, but double essentially of what Briarwood Lakes and Forest Gate are. But those are the three reference points we have in terms of multifamily because we really don't have a large multifamily housing stack.
I think based on those numbers, 2-point-something units per acre, 4-point-something units per acre, in almost every community, that's low density.
Low density.
The 13-point-whatever of the one townhouse development would be considered medium density.
Because right now, I think it says 3-to-4-story. I thought it said medium density.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the illustration, that's what the illustration shows, is okay. A 3- or 4-story product with condominiums. It doesn't state how many anymore. It doesn't state the unit size anymore. So if it's 3-story and they're larger units, or if it goes to in the text, it says, or it could be a townhouse development. So narratively or visually, we illustrate one concept, but narratively we said that it could be a range of residential product. Yep.
Okay. Thank you.
And just one quick comment, because somebody's going to say something to me tomorrow on the phone. I want to clarify, Forest Gate is not multifamily. It is a single family detached project, but they have lesser setback, so just to make that note to differentiate, but it's a little denser than your normal single-family development here.
The other point to remember is both Forest Gate and Briarwood are age-restricted communities. I have a question for you. Number one, you mentioned all the uses that were considered for the McDonald's field. Was a high school ever considered?
No.
Okay. Additionally, the other thing you talk about, the increased traffic flow. Has a traffic study been done so that we might, because if we overbuild, we hurt the mall and the different properties. Looking at the properties, obviously they need some help. Enterprise Drive, and some of these ideas are properties that you've already got parking garages over there, and that, so I can understand the commercial part of it. Here's where you're going to run into your problem when you start mixing the residential and commercial. You're saying that you want to attract the younger crowd. That has a price point. When you do that, you now lower the property values potentially in other areas. Oakbrook built its outstanding reputation, and to get in the good school district, you're at a certain price point. That's going to change when you start introducing multifamily, and that's the slippery slope you're on. We know there is a market when Glenview did it with the Naval Base and when Burr Ridge did it with the Village Center. These markets are trendy, and they're very dependent on a strong economy. So we're looking at already major lenders talking about property values in 2019, 2020. Interest rates are going up. That's where you're going to be on your slippery slope, because if you make the properties cheap enough that, or rentals, that the millennials and the younger people have access to afford, then you're potentially changing the dynamics of Oakbrook, because that has never been a possibility in Oakbrook. Secondly, as far as the McDonald's field being residential, that's a proven failure. Go over to Templeton Ridge. Stand out in front of anyone. It's been going for what, I don't know, 5 years now. And there's only two of the 20 sites that are developed. They're offering $1 million discounts on the site. And why? You stand in front of any one of the buildings and what do you hear? The noise from Route 83. So, and then the density that was pictured, I think that's where you're running into your problem. So if you divide the plan into three phases, what you want to do around the mall in the area to the east of that, I think is very beneficial. Questionable with the residential aspect. What McDonald's does with their corporate property, I mean, that's up to them, and personally, you know, I think however it works out, it'll be good. And then I think the third part where you're going to have an issue is the McDonald's fields, and that is not a good residential site. I would have loved to have seen the park district and the school district get together and build a high school there with our deteriorating, you know, situation, or could be deteriorating. I mean, they didn't get their referendum, so who knows what'll happen there. Thank you.
Okay. Anybody else have any questions or comments?
Just a consideration for the Enterprise Drive, where it's divided now in the plan between mixed use and low business development. It's blue and the orange stripe. It would seem to me it makes a lot more sense that all of that be mixed use. To even though Carrama is going up there, it still would, at least to me, make more sense that that area be integrated rather than having, you know, a strip that is, you know, business, and then you have the mixed use possibility. Whereas
if you make the whole area mixed use, at least it's a more logical unit and might lead to more creativity in development. So I would think that would be at least worth consideration. On the McDonald's Fields, let's presume the Park District is not able to work out a deal with McDonald's. Therefore, the village has the option, and you're suggesting residential. And as a pure residential area, you're going to have a nice place to live, but you have to leave that area every time you want to do something. There are no restaurants in there. Because if it's pure residential, there can't be cleaning, any of those things. And you have the issue of Route 83. And so again, if you're going to create a district there, again, that would seem to be make more sense as a multi-use district rather than a pure residential district. Because then you have the option of creating you have the possibility of having the kind of shops in there and that would support a residential community, whether it's a condominium or retail. I notice in the wording when you refer to you seem to deliberately, I shouldn't make any presumption. You make no reference to whether that is rental or condominium, or one or the other. The few public comments that have been made have referenced condominium only. I personally have no objection to rental. If it's going to be rental, it's going to be very high-end rental. So I have no problem with that. But I guess what I'm concerned with is all the notes and references will reference condominium, and there are some government agencies that would see that's rather restrictive on who's allowed to live in the village. And so I think at least to take that into consideration.
Yeah, the plan typically when it talks about multifamily refers to it as townhomes and condominiums or multifamily above ground floor commercial. It doesn't specify rental. Like the gentleman that spoke, personally, professionally, I don't have any issue with rental. If you're spending $2,500 a month renting a condominium or an apartment, that's okay rental in a high-end community. In fact, that's a trend that renting is a very legitimized, high-end residential housing type. Yes. That said, municipalities, even in zoning ordinances, and the attorney can correct me if I'm wrong, can't regulate whether something is a rental or an owner-occupied unit. When the product, when it comes through PUD, the applicant can say, this will be owner-occupied or we intend this to be rental. But in the zoning ordinance and in the plan, it can't specify it has to be one or not the other.
That's correct. We have no ability to really restrict between the condo and the rental. Right. That's something that's left up to the market.
Well, there are certain ways of restricting it, but that we won't.
Right,
we won't go into that.
But you're right. In the plan, it does refer to when it talks about multifamily, it talks about townhomes and condominiums, or it refers to it as mental multiple family or multifamily. It doesn't specifically identify apartments per se. Right.
These are maybe minor comments, but I'd just like to get them in the record. Page 6F and 6H in our file. They add the exception. It talks about buffered landscaping.
Okay.
And then it said, except for vertical developments. Oh. That's just bad wording, in my opinion. Because what it's saying is you don't have to do any kind because you're left out of the deal. It's just bad wording. The wording should be such that it's should be buffered appropriate to Yeah, so perhaps take that into consideration in the
easy
wording.
Easy fix, yeah.
And the other thing is, in the plans, you suggested the possibility of moving the number 2 fire station from its current location to possibly just west of 83. And my humble opinion about that would be an absolute disaster, because the traffic is so much worse in the suggested location west of 83 than it is in its current location. The ability to get around the village from that location compared to where it currently is probably much would not work as well. It'd be much more difficult to get to places in the village from that location than from the current location.
And just so you know, there's a lot of recommendations in here that were, I would say, a composite or reflection of years worth of discussions at different levels. That option or idea came from the village, not from us as a consulting firm. So it was something that had been thrown out there as, should we examine this? So the plan identifies it based on response time of the current station, the potential of what response time would be here. So that's where that came from.
Yeah. My last thing would be an overview question. Part of the problem in going through the material we had was we had the new draft plan, and then we had the old 07 plan. But, you know, like, when we went through the whole potential revision of zoning, you went through it as a Word document with lines crossed out, and, you know, you had a sense of what you were leaving out and what you were adding. And I would think, I would suggest that when you give something finally to the board, that you give it to them that way, that you give them a document that shows what you've taken out and what you've added. And I would have found, you know, my homework much easier if I was working that way. Last thing, I was just like, if you were to pick out the major changes that you're suggesting in the new document, what would they be?
I think it is the plaza site going from a corporate headquarter building with a sea of parking around it, literally, to a new mixed-use environment of some kind. That's a pretty big change. It's a big piece of property. I think the collective impact of all the transportation infrastructure recommendations we've noted and recommended over in the Windsor Swift area, if those recommendations get implemented over the course of the next decade or whatever, circulation in that area will significantly improve. I think that's a big, big deal. I think the other change that is significant is, obviously, I think based on the reaction of the community, is taking an area that has been open space, privately held, but used as open space for years and years and years and years and years, and then floating the idea of, if this goes to development, what development should go on here? And I think it's something that people haven't thought about. And I think the village is now forced to think about it. And there's a lot of opinions that we've got to vet through to figure out what the plan should reflect for that site. So I think those are the biggest changes. Other aspects of the plan are tweaked. There's no new notions there. Some of the lines may have changed a little bit as to where things should go. But I think those are the three or four biggest, most significant shifts in this document.
Thank you.
You bet.
Dr. Law.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I think just on my fellow residents who raised the issue on the soccer field, I would keep my remarks very simple, and I should declare my conflict of interest. I'm a resident of Ginger Creek since 1978. Currently, I serve on the board of directors of the Ginger Creek Association for more than a decade. I think if you look at the floodway at Soccer Field, this is in Ginger Creek. And we already have problem with the creek itself, sediments, the depth is decreasing, and we are trying to get the village to do something about it so we can get some help. As a matter of fact, our secretary and a couple of other directors are involved in filing application where they can get some funds to do that. So I think it doesn't show this plan that Ginger Creek is a sub-area 8 and old plan referred to as an opportunity site called office development land use plan and does not say multifamily. So I think when you come back, please address that, because that is key, because you are talking about where the outflow is going to be. So that is my concern.
Okay.
Thank you.
Aside from the McDonald's soccer field issue, a lot of the business community spoke tonight, and I think everybody is fairly supportive of the overall vision. So I just want to say thank you to the entire committee, everybody who put the time and effort into this to present this plan.
Thank you.
One question, sorry, I had was the plaza site, is that currently zoned mixed use or is it just commercial?
It's office zoning right now.
Okay, so any mixed use would need to go through ZBA and, or no?
Yeah, and I guess let me, this-
Plan development, sorry.
It begs, so yes, anything would have to go through plan development. And I think just to get at a comment that I think was made by the first speaker, Fred, and I agree with a lot of what he said, a great deal of it. The one thing I think, the distinction I think I would make is that he talked about aligning what we do with the districts. And as a planner, I think it's the exact opposite. You have to make your plan and align your districts with the plan. Zoning is not planning. Zoning is a tool to implement planning recommendation and objectives. You need a plan on the books that articulate your vision of what these areas need to be. Once there is consensus and adopted plan as to what these areas should be in terms of character, intensity, use, and development characteristics, you then amend your districts to accommodate that. But you don't amend your plan to dovetail with the districts. You dovetail your districts to amend to your plan. So that's the only thing I would differ from what he said. I've had several conversations with a million attorneys, maybe it's like you have with planners. So I know exactly what he's saying, and he's spot on. You don't want to get in the weeds. You want to keep the big vision. You want to articulate a vision. You want to set the table for the private investment that makes Oak Brook work and succeed and thrive. It's the village's job to set that table, not try to outthink and outclever anything that may happen that we can't even account for. The plan is the thing that sets that table. The zoning helps deliver it. So I would say that you don't have the plan reflect the district. You do the plan you need to have, and then you amend the district to fit the plan. So that would be the only thing. Everything else that Fred said, I agree with lockstep. So it's just a difference in sort of zoning or planning, which should come first. And I think the emphasis should be on planning. I do a lot of ordinances. Most of the ordinances we work on, zoning ordinances, are done after a plan for an area is adopted. They go, here's our plan, now change our zoning. Nobody says, here's our zoning, now go back and change the plan. I think it's important. So get the plan right per you, per the village trustees, per the members of the community. Get it right. We'll make whatever changes we have to. It needs to reflect the aspirations of Oak Brook, not anybody else. And when the plan is right, we then change the code and the districts to deliver that plan.
Thank you.
Okay. Do any commissioners have anything else that they would like to add or ask for? I think we had heard a lot of testimony tonight. There's a lot of material here that was presented, and I think in all fairness, because it did take over 2 years to put this together, that we should take some time to digest this and meet again on it. And what I would like to do the next time we do meet is on Chapter 6 for the subarea frameworks. I would like to go over each one of these in detail. And I'd like to have the commissioners really take a look at this and make comments that they may, what they may like, what they think may work, what they think may need further improvement, because we have to make a recommendation to the Board of Trustees, and I would like to have something concrete delivered to them other than saying that we like the plan, we approve it. The commission.
I had just one question for Tony. Tony, the draft plan, will it completely replace the 2007 plan?
That's actually a good question, because there's a couple things I referenced in my memo that aren't necessarily in the 2018 version, one of those being like the implementation strategies. So I think it's something we'll probably need to talk about. I don't know if it was overlooked necessarily. I know we have specific recommendation sections, but the intent would be that it would be an update to that plan, but there's also like the beautification and streetscape in there. Some of those may not have been included in this new version, and I'd hate to get into a situation now, we're looking at a 1990, we're looking at a 2007, we're looking at a 2018, so I think we do have to sort that out slightly to see if we carry over a couple of the pages from the 2007 into the 2018 to kind of make this holistic commercial areas revitalization plan, because I think it lends itself to confusion.
That's exactly my concern.
So I think we need to sort through some of that to see how we want. I don't know if it was something that was overlooked again, but I think it's something we need to evaluate to see what we want to do with that final document.
Thank you.
Yeah, sure. And just another comment, just the intent is that we'd continue this to our regular meeting of the Plan Commission. I think it's December 17th, mm-hmm. I want to say. I would encourage anybody here or anybody listening, if there's additional commentary they have, sending it to myself or our department email, or dropping those off by way of letter, just so we can get those into the record, identify any other concerns that have come up. And I emphasize submitting them directly to staff. I know there's been a tendency for emails to go out directly to commission members. We don't give commission members emails out. Those are private emails, but somehow they manage to get to them. We'd also like to make sure they're filtered through us, so everybody's getting the same emails as everybody else, so that one is not going to a certain member and not everybody else. So we would appreciate it getting more comments, but also filtering them through the department. We'll get those out to commission members by way of their packets or individual emails that we'll send out. We usually send an electronic version out prior to a meeting, but it would help to sort through and organize all the commentary we're getting. Thanks.
Thank you. And one other thing I would like to ask the commissioners for our next meeting, too, is to really look at the paragraphs on vision. And if they have any comments on if anything should be further embellished, or they have some other ideas, so that we really have a very strong vision statement, because that really is our guidance for whatever is being recommended.
One thing I would also like to see on the final draft would be the existing sidewalk connectivity. I know you mentioned the proposed, but when I'm looking at this, I can't really figure out what's already there and what you're connecting it to. I think that would be very helpful.
Dr. Lal?
Yeah, Madam Chair, I just want to get a clarity on vision statement. I think the vision statement has to come from our elected leaders, what they want for the village, for the future. We are appointed members by them, but the vision statement, I think in the last one I read, Mr. Doyle is the oldest member in that commission, 1990. And I appreciate his wisdom and his knowledge and really an analysis. At the same time, the trustee at that time was Karen Bushy. So I think I'm not suggesting we should hear from them, but I think it'll be nice to lose that experience at that time, what the process went through.
Yeah, because we don't necessarily have to tool the vision statement, but at least, we could make
You brought it up, so that's why.
To our trustee saying that maybe the statement should be a little stronger, and maybe it should maybe incorporate, give them some ideas.
I'll just note that the Plan Commission is supposed to make a recommendation to the Village Board. The Village Board is the one that will ultimately adopt this, so they can make additional changes to the vision statement if they'd like to.
You totally misunderstood me what I was trying to say. I was trying to say the elected official in this village, they are ultimately responsible for the vision, how they want to conduct, and how they want to see the village grow in next 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, whatever it is. And we are the work on the pleasure of the elected official, and especially the our president of the village. I mean, he can say, okay, goodbye, you know, anytime. So to ask us vision statement, it'll be the same thing, you know, like giving no direction about the plan, and then we are thrust upon this thing. So that's my request. That doesn't mean that it should be taken very, you know, I'm just suggesting that. That's, you understand what I'm saying?
Yes, I understand.
I don't want to get involved in the discussion, but that's what I thought. If you're talking about vision, the elected official has a vision, and they transmit that vision to us to carry on. So I thank you for your...
Okay, thank you, Dr. Lal. Now, at this juncture, I'd like to make a motion that we adjourn, that we continue this public hearing at the next meeting. I'd like to ask the commissioners, we have two options. We can continue this in the December meeting, or we could continue this in the January meeting. Does anybody have a preference?
Well, some of the stuff that we proposed is directly something that they might have to tweak to the plan. So the question is, are you able to incorporate anything now, or will you wait? I'm trying to get some clarity.
There were questions this evening, but there was no direction. There you go, tech. There was conversation and issues raised this evening, but there was no direction, change this, change that, change that, in terms of consensus. So it would be premature to go back and change this working draft now. I think we need to have the discussions, the chair indicated about the more focused sub areas, as well as anything else at the next meeting, whether it be December or January. Mm-hmm. And then once we, because if I do anything now, changes based on discussion, we have a discussion in a month or two about a certain area, changes again, then I'm just, so we need to, this is sort of now the point of focus for discussion. And before any changes get made to this working draft, we should assemble and thoroughly discuss everything. So we have, here's the master list of everything the Plan Commission is directing me to change. Mm-hmm. And then I can make those changes. So I wouldn't make any changes to this prior to the next meeting or two. It wouldn't.
I agree.
Wouldn't be efficient.
I agree. So does anyone have a preference if we continue this December or January?
I would just say, because of the holiday coming, Thanksgiving and then the Christmas, I would suggest January.
Okay.
I do consensus.
Everybody agrees.
Yeah. Okay. Consensus. Yeah, can we have a consensus then?
I concur too. If it doesn't create any difficulty for the other people, I would think that maybe January would be beneficial.
All right. What about you, Tom? It's fine. Right. Okay, so then we would continue.
That would be our next regular meeting then would be Monday, January 21st, 2019.
Okay, for that one then we need to, we have a motion, and we have to have a roll call vote.
Oh, you need a motion and a second. You motioned, you need a second.
A second?
I'll second it.
Okay.
We can do it, we'll do a roll.
Okay.
Doyle?
Yes.
Hassan?
Yes.
Lal?
Yes.
DiBernardo?
Yes.
Wilczek?
Yes.
Stropinski?
Yes. Then this will be continued to our next meeting in January.
First.
Yes. And before we close, any further comments from the public? Okay, may we have a motion for adjournment?
So moved.
Second? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Meeting is adjourned. Thank you, everyone.